Barnabas by Charles Dickens. Audiobook 25x48. There was a sense of closeness from the exclusion of fresh air, and a gloom and heaviness around, as though long imprisonment had made the very silence sad. The homely hangings of the beds and windows had begun to droop, the dust lay thick upon their dwindling folds, and damps had made their way through ceiling, wall, and floor. The boards creaked beneath their tread, as if resenting the unaccustomed page 579/1.119 intrusion. Nimble spiders, paralyzed by the taper's glare, checked the motion of their hundred legs upon the wall, or dropped like lifeless things upon the ground. The death watch ticked, and the scampering feet of rats and mice rattled behind the wainscot. As they looked about them on the decaying furniture, it was strange to find how vividly it presented those to whom it had belonged, and with whom it was once familiar. Grip seemed to perch again upon his high-backed chair, Barnaby to crouch in his old favorite corner by the fire, the mother to resume her usual seat, and watch him as of old. Even when they could separate these objects from the phantoms of the mind which they invoked, the latter only glided out of sight, but lingered near them still, for then they seemed to lurk in closets and behind the doors, ready to start out and suddenly accost them in well-remembered tones. They went downstairs, and again into the room they had just now left. Mr. Haredale unbuckled his sword and laid it on the table, with a pair of pocket pistols, then told the locksmith he would light him to the door. "But this is a dull place, sir," said Gabriel, lingering. "May no one share your watch?" He shook his head, and so plainly evinced his wish to be alone, that Gabriel could say no more. In another moment the locksmith page 580/1.119 was standing in the street, whence he could see that the light once more travelled upstairs, and soon returning to the room below, shone brightly through the chinks of the shutters. If ever man were sorely puzzled and perplexed, the locksmith was, that night. Even when snugly seated by his own fireside, with M.R.S. Varden opposite in a nightcap and night jacket, and Dolly beside him, in a most distracting dishabille, curling her hair, and smiling as if she had never cried in all her life and never could even then, with Toby at his elbow and his pipe in his mouth, and Miggs, but that perhaps was not much, falling asleep in the background, he could not quite discard his wonder and uneasiness. So in his dreams still there was Mr. Haredale, haggard and careworn, listening in the solitary house.